seated for a moment while we continue in worship as Josh gets some baptisms. Amen.
Good morning. Sorry, I don't like this thing. Today we have the honor of celebrating with Tim Cleveland in water baptism. And Tim was one of the first people that I actually met at A2 back in Vestavia. And so this is a true like honor and privilege for me. Just recently, Tim called Pastor Chris and said, "Hey, I just want to let you know I'm all in. Like, let's go." And so right after that, he let Chris know. He said, "I want to follow the Lord in water baptism." And so today we get to do that. We get to celebrate with Tim. And so with that being said, Tim, man, this is just such an honor, for real. I didn't think I was going to get this way. yeah. Tim, based on your confession of faith, it is our honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Guys, so if you guys want to stand up and go ahead and greet somebody across the aisles.
Good morning, A2 Church. My name is Tiffany, and we're so excited to have you with us today. If this is your first time visiting us, thank you so much for taking the time to check us out. If you call A2 home, thanks for coming back. Our goal at A2 is simple. We want to glorify God and lead people into a life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ. We also want to make sure that you know you matter to God and to us, and that you don't leave here with any questions unanswered. In front of you, you'll find a connection card. Take it out, fill it out, and drop it in the container that's going to pass. There's a place on the back for you to let us know about your experience today or to sign up for one of our events. Also, if there's something we can join you in praying about, let us know by writing your request on the back of the card. We have an amazing prayer team that would love to join you in prayer throughout the week.
Ladies, don't miss this opportunity to hang out with some awesome women, enjoy some delicious sweets, and a brief message just for girls. Grab a friend and make plans to join us. RSVP today and sign up to bring your favorite dessert by using your connection card or emailing us at info@a2church.org. Recovery at A2 Church is a Christ-centered, confidential 12-step recovery program that provides a safe place to expose your struggles, addictions, and secrets to the light of Jesus. If you're looking for hope, healing, community, and restoration, welcome home. Recovery meets every Friday at 6:30 p.m. Contact Bethany or DJ Gamble for more info at recovery@a2church.org.
When crisis hits, nothing says you matter like a home-cooked meal. Galatians 6:10 says, whenever we have the opportunity, we should be good to everyone, especially to those in the family of faith. Want to become a part of a team that provides meals for people recovering from a hospital stay, bereavement, etc.? Indicate loving hands on the sign me up section of your connection card, and we'll get you involved. Prayer changes things. More importantly, prayer can change you. Join us at A2 Church every Wednesday morning at 6 a.m. to pray for the needs of our city, nation, families, homes, church, and special needs.
Challenges come in all sizes, and right now we're facing some God-sized challenges at A2 Church. But what if we began viewing every challenge as an opportunity to see God do something amazing and absolutely extraordinary? Make plans to join us for our next Leadership Summit. The summit is for everyone interested in being a part of what God is doing at A2 Church. We need you. Join us for worship, vision, breakouts, and food. If you would like to partner with us in the work that we're doing at A2, you can prepare to do that right now. To give by cash or check, use one of the envelopes in the seat back in front of you. You can also partner with A2 by using our online giving link located on our homepage. Check out your program for more information. Thanks again for being with us at A2 Church. For more info on anything you've heard today, stop by the info desk in the foyer or connect with us online.
His is wigging out.
Let's find this. Good morning, A2 Church.
Good morning.
Yeah.
I think we may have to just cut this one off, the wireless on my head. Let's try it one more time. Good morning, A2 Church.
Good morning.
All right. It is awesome to see you here this morning. Thank you so much for being with us at A2. I want to ask you to do something right now. I want everybody to take out one of those connection cards. You've already heard about it in the video announcement, but go ahead and take that out. If you are our guest, get that prepared right now. If there are prayer needs, go ahead, let us know about those. Ladies, this is your last opportunity to sign up for the Summer Sugar Rush, which is tonight. Go ahead and mark that, how many will be joining. And by the way, you do not have to sign up for the Leadership Summit, but the Leadership Summit is Wednesday night, and we need all of you present for Leadership Summit. Everybody present for Leadership Summit. It is for you. If you care at all about what God is doing at A2 Church, be here Wednesday night for the Leadership Summit. So go ahead and prepare that. For those of you who call this place home, this is your opportunity to prepare to honor God with His tithe and your offering. If you are our guest, we never ask our guests to give anything. We pray that this experience is our gift to you. If you're people who call it home, go ahead and prepare. We're real excited about today. Now, maybe you noticed the cover of your program. It is all about orphan care. There's actually a Sunday in the church calendar year that is designated Orphan Care Sunday, and that is the first Sunday of every November. Well, recently, some months ago, God placed it on the hearts of people in our church to spearhead a ministry at A2 all about orphan care. And we could not wait till November to talk with you about what we can do. So I'm very excited about the package that we've prepared for you, about what God is going to do. And I want you to open your heart. Now, right before the ushers come to receive the connection cards, to allow you to honor God with His tithe and your offering, I want to make a quick family announcement. Everybody knows one of the core values at A2 is make a difference. And here's what that value states. We believe that God has given every individual some amazing gifts, and we want to champion the gifts, talents, abilities, and especially the calling of every individual. And we want to celebrate these gifts and these callings. Approximately 3 years ago, Mary Elizabeth Goodrich became a part of the A2 Church team, and for the last 3 years, she has faithfully served A2 Church in a variety of capacities, including the primary responsibility of Director of Children's Ministries. Some time ago, she began pursuing her master's in mental clinical health. Among other things, this will allow her to serve as a professional and licensed therapist. The next phase in her master's degree will require that her practicum take place at Clay House. Clay House is a place in Bessemer that primarily serves children who have been either physically or sexually abused. The energy, effort required to serve there caused Mary Elizabeth to believe, you know what, I don't think I'm going to be able to balance both of these responsibilities at once. So she met with me. She's going to focus all of her energy on completing her master's. And in the coming week, she'll be stepping down as the director of children's ministry. She'll still be a part of the A2 family, but she'll be stepping down from that. I want us to celebrate this lovely young lady, right? Yeah. So that is awesome. We're going to have an opportunity to do that on July 13th. July 13th, there'll be a reception. So you can come, bring your notes, your cards, and say, hey, M.E., we love you. We care about you. And we're going to pray for you. I've challenged her. That practicum is going to be mentally, spiritually, physically, emotionally exhausting. Just imagine hearing the stories and cases physically and sexually abused children day in and day out. But you're not alone. Your church family is going to be lifting you in prayer. So go ahead and start preparing your cards, your notes, your letters to let this lovely young lady know we're going to be praying for you. And her last Sunday as children's director will be June 27th. The board and I have already been working on this, and I, in the coming days, will be announcing our transition process and the individual who will be leading children's ministry at A2. We're so excited about the future for A2 and for ME. And I've said it all along. We believe when God leads, it's never a leading and then a minus or subtraction situation. He always leads in terms of multiplication and multiplying the ministry of the body of Christ. Amen? So we bless Mary Elizabeth, and we're excited about the next chapter. I want you right now to prepare your hearts. I'm going to pray, and the next few minutes, God is going to begin speaking to you in a powerful way. So just open your heart to hear from God. Father, thanks so much for the opportunity to worship as a family. We lift this body to you. We pray that our hearts be open to what you want to say. Whatever we do, don't let us just hear truth, but motivate us today to respond to truth, to do truth. So we give the next several minutes to you and be honored. This your tithe, our offering, in Jesus' name. Go ahead, prepare your connection cards. This is the time to turn those in and to honor God with his tithe and our offering. Amen.
See the world looking through your eyes. I wanna know.
A king and queen ruled over a magnificent kingdom. Their subjects loved them. Their castle shone like the sun, and there was never any famine or drought. They knew they were very lucky, yet something was missing. One morning, the queen woke up with a pain in her heart. It was a steady ache that filled her with sadness. "I feel it too," the king said. "It feels as if my heart is tearing in two."
Jason and I had always talked about adopting because we didn't know if we'd be able to have our own kids. But 5 years after we got married, we kind of surprisingly on purpose got pregnant with Avelyn. And then less than 2 years after she was born, we had Quinn. And from the time that we were pregnant with her, we didn't really talk about adoption. I don't think we mentioned it once. Mm-hmm. But after Quinn was born, it kind of was still in the back of my mind. And I kept seeing around town this girl. She was about my age. She had beautiful curly red hair, and she had a little Asian toddler. And every time I saw her, I would cry. And finally, I realized why I was crying was because in her and with her child, I was seeing what I felt was missing from our family.
One day, an old peddler wheeled his cart of trinkets into the kingdom. Hearing about the king and queen's distress, he requested an audience. "It is as I thought," the man said when he saw them. "There is a red thread being pulled from your hearts." "A red thread?" the queen gasped. "Where?" "I see nothing," the king said. "Try on my spectacles," the peddler said, holding out his wireframes. "You will see." And sure enough, when the queen put on the glasses, she could see a brilliant red thread coming from her heart. It ran around the room, out the castle door, and far beyond. With every move she made, the thread pulled and twisted, causing her pain. The king, too, saw the thread coming from his heart. The two threads had knotted together into one thick strand.
Out of nowhere, one day, we were driving down 280, and I think Quinn was maybe a year old, if that, so Avelyn probably was not even three. Mm-hmm. I just kind of blurted out, "I still think I want to adopt." And Jason was a little taken by surprise because we'd
deer in headlights kind of deal. Yeah,
we'd only ever talked about having two.
After our own kids were born, I'd kind of, you know, shelved the idea a little bit. You know, just thought, you know, we had our two kids, we were good. And yeah, when she mentioned that to me on the highway, I don't think I quite ran into somebody, but I came really close to. But you know, it was something that, you know, it took me. I mean, and be honest, it kind of took me a little bit of time to get on board with it. And God kind of had to change my heart a little bit, because I don't know that I was really on board with it at first, too, especially, you know, after we, you know, we had our kids.
I kind of told him I felt like it was a calling, that that's what God had called me to do, that we were supposed to adopt.
And then so when the topic came up again, however mm-hmm. what long it was, she said, "Okay, well, I've thought about this," and I just blurted out. I was like, "Let's go get a little girl from China. That's what I want to do." And then she was kind of, I think it was her turn. It was her turn to be shocked that time.
Yet when the thread led them to the shore of a vast sea, they almost despaired. But the thread tugged at them, so they bought a boat and began to row. The closer we got to, you know, signing papers, this fear just kept building inside me. And I just kept thinking, what are we doing? This costs a fortune of money we do not have. Most of these children, you know, are damaged in some way, physically, emotionally, spiritually, and require so much more attention and time and therapies. God gives us impossible situations
so that he can have the glory, because we can't do the impossible by ourselves. So when we accomplish it, it's because he has made us accomplish it. You know, he's not going to call you to do something hard and then hang you out to dry. He's going to provide the means to make it happen. So that's when I realized, you know, the money didn't matter. The money would be there when we needed it. You know, her problems wouldn't matter because he would equip us to deal with them. The time frame wouldn't matter because she would come when she was meant to. That we have to believe that her soul is meant to be in our family. Even though she wasn't born from us, like Evelyn and Quinn were, she's just as much a Helms, no matter what country she's in, or when or how old she is when she joins our family. The end of the red thread was within their sight. They ran to a small bundle in front of an old house. When they reached the bundle, both stopped in amazement. Inside the bundle was a baby. She was laughing and playing and tugging at the red threads tied around each of her ankles. She looked up at the king and queen and smiled. "Whose baby is this?" the queen asked. "Who does she belong to?" Her words were strange to the villagers, who chattered in a language that the king and queen could not understand. Finally, a wrinkled elder pushed herself forward. The elder's bespeckled eyes followed the short red threads connecting the king and queen to the baby. Her face broke into a broad smile. "This baby," the old woman said, "belongs to you." So we have completed our paperwork. We are in process. We are waiting to be matched. So there's not an actual child yet that is ours. We're waiting on that. Hopefully this time next year we will be home from China with her.
You can't solve the problem on your own. You're not going to, but you can solve it for somebody. And you can be God's hand to somebody. And even if it's just one, you made a difference for that one child.
So the king and queen took the baby home to their castle, and she became the princess of the kingdom. They never felt the pain in their hearts again. Instead, they were filled with joy and happiness. They never found out how the red thread had connected them to their daughter, but they knew why, and that was all that mattered. The end.
Change his ways, and no message could have been
then not alone. Oh, willow deeply scarred, somebody's broken heart, and a washed out dream. They follow the pattern of the wind, you see, because they got no place to be. That's why I'm starting.
Are on you in this moment. Strike a straight blow with a crooked rod like myself. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Hey, let me do this. Let me introduce you to some really important people, Jason and Allison Helms. Stand up. You see Jason regularly on the stage. But you just got to hear their story. Thank you, Jason and Allison. Trent and Ashley Geringer. Trent and Ashley, would you stand up right there? I'll talk about them more in a moment, but Jason and Allison, Trent and Ashley, will be at a table in the foyer when you leave to talk with you about orphan care at A2 Church. I'd also like to ask Josh Caldwell. Josh, would you stand? Josh is a couple of rows in back of Trent and Ashley. Let me tell you about Josh. I had the privilege of meeting with Josh a few weeks ago. He is part of what's called Lifeline Children's Services. Lifeline has been serving children and families in the Birmingham area and beyond since before 1984. They are actually celebrating over 30 years of ministry. Lifeline has placed over 3,500 children into loving Christian homes, and they've also provided care and counsel to more than 4,500 women in crisis. Lifeline not only assists in adoption, but they are also very active in foster and orphan care. They've also been very active in reaching out to unwed moms or women in crisis pregnancies. Josh will be in the back at a table to talk with you. But would you please welcome and express appreciation for Lifeline Children's Services. Thank you, Josh. Here's what we wanted to do in the next few moments. We just want to awaken awareness. Awareness of a growing crisis, not only in our community, but our state, our nation, our world. We're going to talk about the orphan crisis for just a few moments, and I'm being really honest when I say a few moments. There are approximately 153 million orphans in the world. 153 million. Now, it's probably important that we take a moment to define what we mean when we say orphan. The word doesn't simply refer to children whose parents are dead or no longer able to care for their children for a variety of reasons. The word orphan refers to children who are vulnerable.
Some of these kids have lost one parent. For instance, of the 153 million orphans in our world, 34.5 million of these kids have lost a mom. Over 100 million have lost a dad. 17.8 million have lost both mom and dad. Some of these kids have been abandoned. Others would simply be described as vulnerable. But no matter how you spin it, orphan is an unwanted and undeserved identity that gets placed upon a child. These kids did nothing to deserve this. Instead, life just sort of happened to these kids. These kids didn't see the movie Annie and think, "I'd like to be an orphan and have a Daddy Warbucks." They didn't see the movie Aladdin and think it'd be great to be an orphan and steal food, ride a magic carpet, and have a pet monkey. That'd be awesome. They didn't see Man of Steel or The Blind Side and think, "Wow, I'd love to be adopted by Kevin Costner or Diane Lane. My wife would like to be adopted by Kevin Costner." No, I'm just kidding. They didn't see Despicable Me and think, "I'd love to be an orphan and get a supervillain named Gru to be my dad and have lots of minions serve me." That's Hollywood. That's romance. It's not reality. Life just sort of happened to these kids. Movies and entertainment may romanticize the idea of being an orphan, but in reality, guys, next statement is going to be harsh, but there's no other way to put it. The reality is life as an orphan sucks. Now, that's not my normal language, but I don't know how else to describe it. One of the staggering effects of the AIDS crisis is that today in Africa, over 14 million children have been orphaned because of AIDS. And a significant number of those surviving children presently have AIDS or HIV. Every 15 seconds, another child becomes an AIDS orphan in Africa. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Another AIDS orphan in Africa. Recent study by UNICEF indicates that in the Ukraine and Russia, 10 to 15% of children who age out of an orphanage commit suicide by the age of 18. 60% of the girls are lured into prostitution. 70% of the boys end up in prison. Over 1 billion children around the world suffer from at least one form of severe deprivation of basic needs such as water, food, sanitation. That's the bad news. Here's hope. If only 7% of the world's 2 billion Christians, if only 7% sponsored a child. Only 7%, we could eradicate the orphan crisis. Let's talk about the crisis at home. There are almost 400,000 children in the foster care system in the U.S. According to the Department of Health and Human Services, about 123,000 of these kids are orphans. Others of these kids wind up in the foster system due to abuse, neglect, abandonment, special needs, or poverty. Approximately 102,000 of these kids are waiting to be adopted. And that's the problem. Here's hope. If only one-third of all the churches in America, if only one-third of all the churches in America had only one family in each of those churches say, "I'll adopt a child, all 102,000 of those kids would be placed in a Christian home. Here's the sad part. 32% of those kids will spend over 3 years in foster care waiting to be adopted, longing to be adopted, and a significant number, over 20,000, will age out of foster care every year. And most of those who age out of the system age out into either severe poverty or a life of crime. Let's get real close to home. Jefferson and Shelby counties alone, there are 1,500 kids in the foster care system, with only 300 currently trained families available to provide care for those children. But if only one family in each church in the Birmingham area would foster a child, the foster care crisis in Jefferson and Shelby County would be eradicated. Anybody feel the weight of this? I mean, it's pretty overwhelming, isn't it? And that's why, as I thought about this message, I could share a boatload of scriptures with you this morning. I'm not. I'm going to share two passages with you. And the first passage is the gist of the message. And by the way, this passage is enough because it hits like a sucker punch to the mouth. James 1:27 is the passage. You can look at your notes. You can turn there in your Bible. The book of James, chapter 1, verse number 27. And here's the way it reads. Are you ready? It'll come up on the screen. In fact, it is there. Let's just do something. Let's read this out loud and together. Would you do that with me? Out loud and together. Pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows in their distress and refusing to let the world corrupt you. Now, some of us read that, and the word religion immediately causes us to put our guard up. In fact, if you've been attending A2 for any time at all, you know that I often say things like this: Christianity is not about religion, it is about a what? Relationship with Jesus. And that's true, but in the book of James, the word James uses that gets translated in almost every English translation of the Bible, religion doesn't refer to rules keeping. It doesn't refer to ritualistic principles. The word that gets translated, religion, actually refers to deep devotion, or get this, worship of Jesus Christ. With that in mind, read it like this. Where the word religion is, I want you this time to insert the word worship. Are you ready? We're going to read it again, but where religion, you're going to insert the word worship, and you're going to read it loud enough so that you know what you've read. You're not just going to speak through this so that you can forget about it easily. Read it loud enough so that you feel the weight of what it says. You ready? Pure and genuine worship in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows in their distress and refusing. James doesn't define pure and genuine worship as coming into an air-conditioned environment for an hour and 15 minutes on Sunday morning and lifting up your hands and singing, "This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place." That's worship. But that's not the way James is going to define it. He said there's a rubber meets the road aspect. There's an aspect of worship where you put on a pair of blue jeans, an old ratty t-shirt, a pair of work boots, and you get in the trenches. And when you wipe the snot from the nose of a vulnerable child. When you hang sheetrock in the home of a woman who's been orphaned, or a family that is incredibly vulnerable, with every nail you pound into the wall, with every loving Kleenex you wipe across a child's face, that is worship, and it touches the heart of the Father. So let me just give you two characteristics of true religion or authentic faith. You ready? Not going to be a long message. It's pretty short. Here's the first. Personal purity in your attitudes and actions. Pure and genuine religion, worship in the sight of God the Father, means refusing to let the world corrupt you. Can I tell you, the church that I grew up in emphasized this aspect of authentic faith. Get it right ethically. Get it right morally. Get it right. Man, the church I grew up in had so many rules that it made a relationship with God incredibly difficult. Can I tell you, personal holiness and personal purity are crucial, but that's only part of the definition of what it means to have authentic faith. If y'all are okay, I'm okay. Okay? Are we not okay out there? We're not okay. I just see commotion and it's distracting me, so I'd rather take care of it. So Chris, we're leaving this thing on my face and we're going with this. The second characteristic of true religion or authentic faith. Here it is, personal compassion for the hurting and the helpless. Pure religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows. Orphans and widows were the most vulnerable set, the most at-risk set in Jewish culture in that era. That's why it would be a mistake to focus on the technical definition of what it means to be an orphan or widow. Here's the implication. If you see somebody vulnerable, helpless, at risk, and you have the ability to get involved, you have the ability to do something, then you've got to do it. Underline the word caring there. It gets translated look after or visit in other translation. It's actually a word that means to advocate for or to do justice for orphans and widows. And this is one of the themes of the Old Testament prophets. The actual word carries the idea of extending love, extending compassion, extending sympathy, extending kindness, extending grace. Sometimes that can be communicated through the simple loving act of listening. Just Friday, crisis occurred. And that is normally my day off, but there was a lady suffering from cancer with only a few days to live, and she has lived most of her life as an agnostic or an atheist. And I got the call. They've only given her a few days. Can you visit with her, a good friend? I just want to know that she's okay with Jesus. And I walked into the room. Myself and Chris Molesky accompanied me. Walked into the room of this widow. Cancer ravaging her body and her mind. Chris and I introduced ourselves, and for the next hour, we sat and listened. And it was torturous. At least five times, I counted. Through leaving breath, this expression has haunted me since. She said, There is no. There is no peace. And she continued to repeat that expression.
and finally relented and allowed us to pray for her. She did not surrender. Please pray for her. Visits. We'll be going back there this week. Sometimes caring means listening. At other times, it requires more heavy lifting, but it always will require energy, effort, and action. See, what I want you to see from James 1:27 is that according to James, authentic faith is marked by more than just personal purity. It's also marked by practical compassion. It's not an either-or proposition. It is a both-and kind of proposition. So how do we respond? Here's our response. One of our goals at A2 is to create a culture at A2 that not only says they believe in walking out James 1:27, we want to create a culture that actually walks out, lives James 1:27. Tom Davis said it like this in his book, Fields of the Fatherless. When it comes to caring for the people on God's heart, indifference is a sin. So let me walk you through this. That means we want to be a church that champions the stories of people like Jason and Allison Helms. We want to champion the beauty of adoption. We want to help people, assist people, champion people, care for people, encourage people who feel the calling to adopt. People like, I asked Trent and Ashley Derringer to stand. Trent, Ashley, Jason, and Allison, we ate dinner in my home some time ago. They shared with me their calling concerning orphans. I heard Allison and Jason's story and then turned to Ashley and said, share with me your story. She said, we're really praying about it, but right now we have some significant challenges. One of the challenges was just to start the process, they needed an application fee of $3,000. And then we're praying. This week, I received a call from Ashley. I'm going to try my best to quote her. She can confirm or correct the story if I blow it. The end of the meal that evening, we prayed, and I felt prompted by the Holy Spirit to pray boldly that God would provide $3,000. She called me earlier this week. Would be last week now, right? She said, Chris, something about that prayer challenged me. I went home and I told Trent, we need to start praying boldly that God would provide. Short version of a longer story. She called to say, God has blessed Trent's career. They have been able to raise all $3,000 to apply for adoption, and they are pursuing that in earnest in obedience to the call of God upon their life. Guys, we want to be a church that champions people like that. In fact, you can learn more with Josh, Ann, Trent, Ashley, Jason, and Allison. Next week, there is an Orphan Care Ministry informational meeting at 5 o'clock in this room. Be here. They'll put teeth into this. Not only that, we need to be a church that champions foster care. There are families in this room who can make a difference in foster care. Josh and the people at Lifeline will be leading foster care training. The next training kicks off in September, and I would love to see people from A2 say, you know what? I'll go through the training. I'll become certified. I'm going to tell you from all the research, the stories that I've heard and read, it will be challenging. It will not be easy, but it will be worth it. If you don't feel called to adopt or foster, you can become part of a WRAP team, W-R-A-P. And that means you'll provide words of encouragement, respite care, acts of kindness, and prayer. Again, the team will be talking more about that next Sunday night. If you can't do any of these, a significant number of the orphans in our world are deemed unadoptable. It doesn't mean they can't be cared for. It means because of restrictions in those countries or other issues, those children will never be able to be adopted, but you can sponsor a child. And we've given you links in your notes so that you can sponsor a child. It's why I love the cover of your program and the insert. Adopt if you can't adopt. Foster if you can't foster. Sponsor if you can't sponsor. Volunteer if you can't volunteer. Donate if you can't donate. Pray. You see, the question is not, nobody needs to leave here saying, Lord, if you want me to do something. That is an in vain prayer. We don't have to pray about things God's word clearly defines. None of us should pray, if you want me to pray. The only prayer we should pray is, Lord, how do you want me to get involved? Remember, this is about vulnerable people. If you can't do any of those, maybe you can volunteer your energy with an organization like Operation 127. Just scroll the pictures, David, if you would. Yesterday, a team of people from Operation 127 and A2 Church traveled to Albertville, Alabama to do intense home repairs on the home of Mr. and Mrs. Quintino. Their daughter, Juliana, was diagnosed with cancer at 15. The cancer went into remission, came back, she's 18, and the doctors have diagnosed the cancer as terminal. Their home is unlivable. The need was brought to us by Iris Hall. Working at Children's, became aware of the need, and the hope of the family is that Juliana would be able to return home and spend, unless God heals her, the last few months of her life at home. Operation 127 raised all of the funds, and yesterday, some of you, as well as extended friends of A2 Church and Operation 127, traveled there, and in the next few days, Juliana will be able to move back into her home, and her loving and diligent family, they're a very diligent family who've just not been able to do these basic repairs, are blown away at your service and the kindness of Operation 127. Andy and Carol Lane, who are part of our body, stand up. Stand up, Andy and Carol. They lead Operation 127. I was there for just a few short hours yesterday. I had an appointment back in Birmingham. But I want you to know, with every nail that was placed in the wall, hardwoods that were laid on floors, electrical repairs that were done, that was pure, genuine worship in the sight of God. I'm aware right now, by the way, where is Greg Gilbert? Greg, wave at me. Greg, stand up if you would. I'm aware right now of a single woman in our church, an adult woman with debilitating arthritis. Debilitating arthritis. Because of that, she can't do some necessary painting in her home, nor some very basic and minimal repairs. Greg Gilbert is going to lead a team from A2 Church to go into that home to paint and do those basic repairs. Why? Because that's what the church does. That's the way the church loves. That's what worship is all about. I told you it was going to be short. Let's wrap up. Ben, Jan, come on to the keys. Maybe you're saying, why get involved? I taught you two verses. Let me just give you this one. By the way, there are 200 passages in the Bible that speak to the plight of widows and orphans. 200. There are 400 passages that speak to the issue of poverty. So again, this is not an if kind of scenario. This is how. How do I serve? How do I get involved? Why? Psalm 68:4, sing praises to God and to his name. Sing loud praises to him who rides the clouds. So God likes it when you sing. I'm not dissing that form of worship. His name is the Lord. Rejoice in his presence. Why get involved? Verse 5. Father to the fatherless, defender of widows. This is God whose dwelling is holy. God places the lonely in families. He sets the prisoners free. He gives them joy. See, if anything ought to motivate us, it ought to be the fact that when we were helpless and hurting, when we were alienated from God, when we were spiritual orphans, God took the initiative, according to Ephesians 1, Galatians 4, in eternity past, to adopt us into his forever family. The Bible has all kinds of terms to refer to our relationship with God. It uses terms like forgiven, cleansed, redeemed, reconciled. But one of the most powerful metaphors in all the Bible to refer to us is this: we have been adopted. And that's what caused David Platt, Pastor Brook Hills Church and an adoptive parent himself, to say this: we adopt not because we are rescuers. This is one of the most awesome statements I've ever heard. We adopt because we've been rescued. Can somebody say amen? So open up your program, take out that insert that says adopt. If you can't adopt, foster. If you can't foster, sponsor. If you can't sponsor, volunteer. If you can't volunteer, donate. If you can't donate, pray. And look at the back. My response. Would you get a pen out and just mark your response? And then I'm going to have to ask you to help us because of our lapse in detail in relation to this form. I have adopted, or I foster children in my immediate family. We have some stories in this church of adoption, and I wanted to ask those individuals to stand, but because this is a very sensitive subject, I felt like those stories are the stories of those families to tell, and unless I've personally talked to them, I want them to be able to have the privilege of sharing what I think are some of the most beautiful stories I've ever heard. Let us know, though, if you have adopted or you currently foster. I wanted information on how to adopt, how to foster. Check that. I want information on sponsoring an unadoptable child. I'll volunteer to be on a RAP team. I've already explained what that means. I'll give so that A2 can care for orphaned, abandoned, vulnerable children. I'll commit to praying for orphan, abandoned, vulnerable children or adoptive families or foster families. And finally, I'll attend the Orphan Care Ministry informational meeting next Sunday at 5. Go ahead and respond right now. Again, it's not if you'll be involved, it's how. Nobody here needs to pray if, Lord, you want me to be involved. It's how, Lord, do you want me to be involved? Now, this is our lapse. Our lapse in detail is we asked you to commit and we didn't give you a place to put your name, email, or phone number. And it hit me like a ton of bricks this morning. Too late to correct. Anywhere on this form, don't just sign it. Listen, let me tell you. Anonymous forms mean nothing to anyone. In fact, just so you'll know, anonymous connection cards with complaints go straight into file 13. Anonymous connection cards where I get getting like this, didn't put your name, that goes straight in file. You know what that means? That means it goes into the trash. Let me make it real plain. I don't care. I care about people who sign their name and they're like, I want to help. Not, I just want to sit back. Anonymous commitments mean nothing. Put a name, even though we were the culprit here. Gave me a chance that they'll give you a great diatribe, right? Put a name. Make sure we can read the name. Put an email address. Make sure we can read the email address. Put a phone number. Make certain we can read the phone number. Got it? And that's how you're going to worship as you leave. You're just going to take that, fold it over, and in the containers in the back, you're going to leave that. Now maybe you're here and you say, I've not been adopted into the family. You can right now. I want to lead you in a prayer to receive Jesus and to become a member of his family. You're his creation now, but it's faith in Christ that makes you a member of his family. So just say this out loud. Faith family, say it with me. Heavenly Father, here I am. I thank you. Jesus, in eternity past, chose me. Right now, I choose him. I want to be adopted into his forever family. Amen. The rest of you, let's just pray this out loud together. Now that we know we're to be a part of it, responding to this crisis, just say out loud, Heavenly Father, here I am. Use me. The question is not if I should get involved. The question is how I will be involved. Lead me. Speak clearly to me. Amen. Amen. Guys, pray God blesses you as you go with him this morning. Take those four and put them in the containers that are on the high tops in the back as you exit. God bless you. Thank you for being with us. I'll be up front if you'd like to pray or talk.